This is Ring of Dragons, Age of the Sorcerers, Book 4, by Morgan Rice. Narrated by Kevin E. Green. Chapter 1. Master Grey stood over Royalsport, arms spread wide as he held the tides of the city's rivers unnaturally high, feeling the great weight of all that was happening starting to bear down on him. He'd known that so much of this would come, known that there would be many deaths along the way, but the reality of it was worse, far worse. A bead of sweat dripped down his face as he looked out over the city below, the darkness proving no impediment to him. He'd learned that secret long ago. Below he could see Royalsport spread out, carved up into its separate districts by the onrush of the water, each now a small island unto itself. Across those islands, hundreds if not thousands of troops in the red and purple of King Ravin's men swarmed. His magic had broken them up into separated groups, at least, and meant that the largest bulk of the forces were still trapped on the outskirts of the city, able to do no more than put a containing ring around Royalsport's exits. Another group was in the district where the House of Weapons usually belched smoke and flame, even in the dark, but now its furnaces lay silent, the men there caught up in the defence of it. More had spread into the other districts, around the houses of scholars, of merchants, of sighs. Cut off from one another they might do less damage, but there was still plenty of harm they could do, and might, now that they had seen so many of their own washed away. Master Grey winced at that thought. How many lives had he taken tonight, tumbling and broken along the river banks, or drowned in the depths? However many it was, they were more faces for that tally that the sorcerer kept within himself, and that some part of him knew would have to be paid some day. Eventually all things came due. All this to keep them from a rush on the castle that would have seen those within slaughtered as the soldiers gave way to bloodlust. In that, at least, Master Grey had succeeded. Below he could see the group led by King Ravin trapped in the noble district near the castle, unable to progress. A part of Master Grey wished that he could simply reach out and stop the man's heart with his magic. It would save so much suffering to come, but to do it would set too many other things in motion. He had to trust that the things that were already happening were sufficient, that the people involved were all that he had hoped they would be. In any case, doing such things with magic twisted men too much. He was not one of the hidden, to override the balance of things and become progressively more warped. He worked with that balance, and that was what gave him power. As if to remind him of the limits of that power, Master Grey found his hands shaking. Yet he maintained the spell, his mind holding in place all the delicate links of connection required to send water rushing where it should not. Every second he held this was one in which those within the castle could prepare more, and that events could progress along the paths given to them. Master Grey thought of Devin, sent to collect the fragments of the unfinished sword, of Erin fighting down below in the alleys, of the figures yet to play their parts in all of this. For now his part was simple, he had to hold on. Second by second, though, minute by minute, it was getting harder. Sooner or later he would fail, and then the storm of violence would follow. King Ravin stared up at the tower that stood off to the side of the castle. The sorcerer stood there atop it, and for a moment Ravin was sure that the man was looking his way. That was good. Let him see the enemy who was coming for him, and for all of them. Around him the buildings of the noble district stood quiet and dark, the inhabitants within too frightened to come into the streets. They had good reasons to be afraid. Around Ravin the bodies of those who had stood in his way lay hacked down, still in death. Before, the enemy's soldiers had tried to block their advance into the district, but now only his own men stood there. They owned the streets here, the men waiting in silence for his commands.
"What do you require of us, my king?" one of his officers asked. "Do we continue to the castle?"
Ravin considered it. He was sure that at least some of his men would throw themselves into the water of the castle's moat if he commanded it. And if he'd had his full forces there, maybe he would have considered it, bridging the gap with the sheer weight of numbers. He had only these few, though, and in any case there was no need. Ravin was no magus, but he had learned about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.